God, we ask that you will lead and guide and direct us in all that we do, Lord. God, we ask that you will forgive us of all of our sins, Lord. Forgive those who trespasses against us. Lord, we thank you. Thank you for your grace, your blessings, and all your favor, Lord God. Father, we just ask that you will bless our pastor today, Lord, as he delivered the word, Lord God. Strengthen him, Lord. And Lord, let us receive your word and make a difference in our lives. We forever give you all the honor, praise, and glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. How many thankful folk in the house this morning? Are you thankful? Did you come to give God the praise? Did you come to give him glory? Hallelujah.
We come to lift our hands and give him glory. We come to lift our hands and give him praise. We come to lift our hands and give him glory. We come to lift our hands and give him praise. Give him glory. Give him glory. We come to lift our hands and give him praise. Give him glory. Give him glory. We come to lift
thankful people. Give him praise. Hallelujah.
Are slipping away. The economy's down. People can't get enough pay. As for me, all I can say is thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. Yeah, hey. You didn't have to do it, but you did, Lord. There are folks without homes, they're living out in the streets, and the drug habits, some say, they just can't beat. They're muggers and robbers, no place seems to be safe, but Lord, you've been my protection every step of the way, and I want to say thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me.
gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures for all generations. Be thankful. Hallelujah.
Let's hold unto God. Yes.
Are you holding on to his unchanging hand? Are you holding on to God's unchanging hand? Woo! Hallelujah. My. Kind of hard to let that thing go. Somebody got up to eat some turkey the other morning and they didn't get up. My. Hold on. Hold on to God's unchanging hand. Woo! My. Mm. Didn't no alarm clock get me up this morning. I've been holding on to his unchanging hand. Huh? That's who got me up this morning. Wasn't an alarm clock. Hallelujah. Mm. My. Hey! On it, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the great I am. Yes, sir. Been better to you than it been to yourself. Jesus, for the blood running warm in my veins this morning. Oh, you didn't have to do it, but you did. Been better to me than I've been to myself. Thank you, sir. My God. Woo. I thank you the goodness of the Lord. Lord, I ain't where I'm supposed to be, but I ain't where I used to be. Woo. My. Poplar Spring, y'all like you want to worship this morning. That's all right. That's all right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey, my. Hallelujah. I'm just crazy enough to believe that there's a God running up and down these pews this morning. Crazy about him. I love him so much. There's a sweet spirit in here this morning. I'm going to try to move on. Thank you, Lord. Another year has gone and passed, and it's the Advent season again. Pastor has put me in charge, and instead of scripture for the next 5 weeks, we're going to light a candle. Amen? For the next 5 weeks. The meaning of the Advent wreath. Advent from the Latin word Adventus means arrival, is the 4 week period prior to Christmas. It is a time to ponder the great sacrifice that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ made for us by coming to earth as an infant. He lived a perfect life, died a sacrificial death, and rose from the dead for us. He saved us from our sins and eternal damnation because of his great love, and adopts each person individually into his family through baptism and faith in him. An Advent wreath can be a teaching tool and a reminder for Christmas of the true meaning of Christmas. Traditionally, the Advent wreath symbolizes the passage of the 4 weeks of Advent. It is typically a circular candle holder that holds 5 candles. During the season of Advent, 1 candle of the wreath is lit each Sunday until all of the candles, including the 5th candle, are lit on Christmas Day. Each candle customarily represents an aspect of spiritual preparation for the celebration of the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. Most Advent wreaths use 3 colors of candles, purple, pink, and white. However, some may use blue in place of the purple. The first candle will be lit and the reading done by the Gardner family.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The first candle, which is the purple candle, the prophecy candle, or the candle of hope. We can have hope because God is faithful and will keep the promises made to us. Our hope comes from God. Romans 15, 12, and 13 read, and again Isaiah says, the root of Jesus will spring up, one who will arise to rule over the nations. The Gentiles will hope in him. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Again, Romans 15, 12, and 13.
Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Good morning, Jesus. It's then and again another time that I come as humble as I know how, thanking you first and foremost for being the head of our lives. Thanking you, Father God, for all that you've done so far, all that you're going to do, all that you will do in the future. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the lighting of the candle, the first candle. We ask you to bless the reading and the lighting of the first candle. Lord, we pause for a moment and ask you to touch our pastor right now as he prepares to bring your word, hide him behind the veil. Hold him up. Put mercy on one side. Lift him up with love on the other. Hold him up. Have him to give us a word. Teach us in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, Lord. Bless his family. Have mercy on them. Bless each and every family under the sound of my voice. Please, Lord, those that are sick. touch them from the crowns of their heads to the soles of their feet. Lord, we ask you to bless this choir, touch their voices, anoint them, God. Lord, we ask you to touch each and every ministry in Poplar Spring. Have mercy on us, Lord. We are a church with purpose. We are changing every day. And we thank you for it, Lord. Thank you for it, Lord. Lord, we're ever minded to give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. It is in Jesus' name that I pray this morning. Amen, amen, and amen.
You to know that God specializes in things impossible. He loves to move when all hope seems lost, just so he can show himself strong on your behalf. But you can't give up. He'll come through for you. There will be glory. this song is to encourage you and let you know that no matter what season you're in right now, there is still glory coming. After every test, there is a testimony. After every trial, there's a triumph. There will be a praise. After this, there will be joy. After this, there will be a testimony. After this, there will be glory. After this,
there will be a praise.
heaven, I'm holding on. Come on now, don't be ashamed of it. Tell heaven, I'm holding on. I've come too far to stop right now. I'm holding on. Come on, come on. Call that thing into the natural. Lean over to your neighbor and tell your neighbor, I'm holding on. Let us bless God with a hand clap of praise. Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that's within me. Bless his holy name, for he has done great things. Has he done anything great for you this morning? Bless. Bless. Bless his holy name. Yeah. Yes, sir. I've learned that in the walk of life, grateful folk don't mind telling God thank you. But if he's never done nothing for you, and I'm not trying to get all up in your personal, you find it hard to thank God. But let me help some of y'all just for a moment. When you were in distress and you said it out of repetition, and you said it because it was the norm, you said, Lord, help me with this. Lord, if you get me out of this. Lord, if you just bless me for a moment. See, those are feeble words to the minds of humans. But that stuff goes up to heaven. And look, even though you don't know how to construct it and put it together, it says that there's a great mediator by the name of the Holy Spirit. He picks it up, then he takes it to Jesus, and then Jesus takes it to the Father, and Jesus tells the Father, even though they don't know what they were praying for, but they know they needed some help, can you just help them out? So when that blessing falls from the hand of God, then it goes to the hand of Jesus, then it moves through the Holy Spirit, and then you see yourself walking in a different way, you can't help but to tell God, thank you. And then I say those who have the Nebuchadnezzar spirit, you think you only did it all by yourself. You think you've created your own little world. Can't no one do it like you. You just watch out. God is still in control, right? Let me show you how much, and we got to move on. Let me show you how much he's in control. That he can still stop by just for a little while and heal your body. He can still stop by and change your situation. Now check this out. The scripture says weeping may endure. I'm going to keep on saying that. Weeping may endure for a night. Now if you're up this morning, last night, if you had despair, it was last night. If you was in distress, it was last night. If you were in pain, that was last night. If you had hiccups, headaches, and hangups, that was last night. If you were about to lose your mind, that was last night. If you had yesterday bills, that was last night. But you want to tell somebody, I got up this morning with the Lord on my mind.
joy this morning. Now, can I get about five of y'all that don't mind standing up and just thank God for your morning?
Grateful, grateful, grateful.
bless the Lord. Come on, let us bless him. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. God is good. That's all I can say. God is good. God is good. Pray with me just for a moment. Father, we thank thee and we bless your name in this place. God, we thank you for your many blessings, and God, we thank you for watching over us. God, give us preaching power. God, I pray that you would take the broken parts of this congregation and God, give us preaching power. We thank you in advance for what's going to take place and how you will manifest yourself. Give us preaching power. It's in the name of Jesus. We thank you in advance. We thank you in advance. We thank you in advance. And the people of God said amen. Give God a praise right there. Just for a moment, turn with me to 1 Samuel, the 16th chapter. 1 Samuel, the 16th chapter. And I want to start at verse number 1, if it's okay with you. Amen. 1 Samuel. Are you there? Amen. The reading of the word, 1 Samuel, the 16th chapter. And the Lord said unto Samuel, how long wilt thou mourn for Saul, seeing I have rejected him from reigning over Israel? Fill thy horn with oil and go. I will send thee to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided me a king amongst his sons. And Samuel said, how can I go? If Saul hear it, he will kill me. And the Lord said, take an heifer with thee and say, I come to sacrifice to the Lord. And call Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show thee what thou shalt do. And thou shalt anoint unto me, unto him whom I name unto thee. And Samuel did that which the Lord spake, and came to Bethlehem, and the elders of the town trembled at his coming, and said, comest thou peaceably? And he said, peaceably, I come to sacrifice unto the Lord. Sanctify yourself, and come with me to the sacrifice. And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and called them to the sacrifice. And it came to pass when they come, he looked upon Eliab and said, surely the Lord's anointing is before him. But the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on his countenance or on the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord seeketh not as man seeth, for man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, neither hath the Lord chosen this. Then Jesse made Shammah to pass by. And he said, neither hath the Lord chosen this. Again, Jesse made 7 of his sons to pass before Samuel. And Samuel said unto Jesse, the Lord hath not chosen this. And Samuel said unto Jesse, are here all thy children? And he said, there remaineth yet the youngest. And behold, he keepeth the sheep. And Samuel said unto Jesse, send and fetch him, for we will not sit down till he come hither. And he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and wherewith of
beautiful countenance and goodly to look to. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is he. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. So Samuel rose up and went to Ramah. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of God. I want to talk for the next little while. I got about 10 and a half minutes. Amen. I want to talk for the next little while. God knows your potential. Amen. Someone celebrate right there and give God a hand clap of praise. God knows your potential. Amen. And in this particular piece of what we call the history or the chronological studies of the Bible, God uses ordinary people to do extraordinary things. When the church itself wants to look to do great things, I believe that we can find sure nuggets in the history part of the Bible, that we can see God moving and manifesting himself using mankind to do supernatural things. When we talk about potential, we understand that it is a development to where God or that we have to be developed into what God is calling us to do. Simply, you may not see it now, but if you stay with it, it will manifest itself in the future. Potential is in each individual that I'm speaking to this morning. But sometimes that potential has to be tapped into that you may do that which you've been called out to do. Yes, yes. Great running backs don't become great running backs overnight. Great basketball players do not become great basketball players overnight. Great leaders do not become great leaders overnight. Magnificent Christians do not become outstanding Christians overnight. But someone ought to say, I got potential in me, amen? And if you keep working at it, if you don't give up, if you trust in yourself, believe in your gifts, understand that God has given you a calling. When you begin to trim the fat, when you become dedicated to the task, when you begin to look to God for your help, when you understand that sometimes you may be misunderstood and you won't get a witness, that's when potential begins to flow in your life. Do I have a witness? Y'all gonna talk to me this morning? You got to understand is that you cannot wake up in the morning and just think you're going to conquer everything in your world. But there are baby steps. That is what we call a beginner's manual. Amen? But the great thing I love, church, is that the God we serve, the God we believe in, the God that we love, the God that we sing and pray and preach about, he sees your potential this morning, amen? And check this out. I want to help you out real quick. He's not the only one that sees your potential, but the devil sees your potential too. He sees what you can be in the future. He sees what you got. God has ordered your steps. He sees the blessings that God has laid out for you. And his job is to get you off track so that you will not reach your full potential. But someone ought to tell yourself, I had to lose some things to get this. I had to walk by myself sometime. Every now and then, I find myself being my friend, my cousin, as well as my best neighbor. But you got to be glad this morning that God did not give up on you, that God did not turn his table on you, that God did not shut the door on you. You had to press your way, but God still made a way. You had to lose some things, but you lost some things, but you got
got more than you need right now. When you did not believe in yourself, it was a quickening word from God that got you back on track. You ought to look at yourself and say, I got potential in me. Yes, it may look rough on the outside, but I got potential in me. I may not have the best dialogue. I may not be grammatically correct, but I got potential in me. I may not have the best job right now, but I got potential in me. I may not live in a house on a hill, but I got potential in me. Do I have anybody like that? And when God comes forth, the words you got to speak is that, look here, honey, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, nor entered into the hearts of man what God has in store for me. When you know that God is with you, when you know that God is working with you, you don't have to wait for a cheering group, but you can thank him in advance. Can I get five of you right now and just start thanking God in advance? I may not have it, but I'm going to thank him in advance. I may not be there, but I'm going to thank him in advance. I may not see it all, but I'm going to thank him in advance. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, nor entered into the hearts of man what God has in store for you. Give God a praise right there. Come on, come on. Potential. Noah had potential, even though he was building a ship on dry land. Moses had potential, even though he stuttered and had a staff in his hand. Peter had potential, even though he broke every kind of spelling word and tore it up and cussed and fussed, but he had potential. When Jesus, if it didn't mess you up, he had potential. When he got lost from his mama and daddy and they had to come back and get him, you have potential this morning. Stop talking about where you came from. Stop talking about what you don't have. Stop talking about who don't like you, who don't love you, who won't be in your circle. Start thinking on the things of God and see where God is trying to take you. You got potential in you. Someone ought to shout right there. You got potential. Maybe some of y'all on made it and you on moved on up like the Jeffersons, but some of us are still dying here and God is still working on us. Yeah. And God, let me help you. God sees your potential. Can I stop there just for a moment? Stop allowing people to speak into your life what God has already ordained. Help me out, somebody. The reason they don't want you to have the better job because they're not qualified for the better job. The reason they don't want you to have this is because they can't afford it. Amen? But think about all the sacrifices you've made to get where you're at. When everybody else was going out to lunch, you was bringing your lunch in a brown bag. Amen? Help me out. Oh, I'm the only one that's done that. Amen? Yeah. Uh-huh. When everybody else was eating out, you were grilling out. Help me out, somebody. When everybody else was shopping, you was down at the thrift store. Amen? When everybody else was having everybody else to do everything for themselves, you found yourself doing it. And how dare you hide the blessings of God, and he's blessed you over and over and over. Someone gonna catch that in a minute, and over and over and over again. When you look here, honey, you have learned how to do without. You have learned how to be obese. You have learned how to be abound. And in everything you've been, you have not complained. So why not? Honey, you are the great candidate for God to shower blessings in your life. He sees your potential because you've been faithful over a few things, and now he's making you ruler over many. I got to move. I got some more with that. I want to leave that alone. But church, what a familiar story. You can walk this text with me. You know it. Saul himself
who is man's king, and you go back in the beginning of a few chapters, understand that Israel thought that they needed a king because everyone else had a king. Uh-huh. But somebody ought to say, what looks good is not always good for you. And then, you know what I'm talking about? Yeah, yeah. He ripped and he looked good, but he ain't good for you. Help me out, somebody. Yeah, she pretty, but she ain't good for you. So, what did Saul do so bad that the Spirit of God is removed? Y'all, that's serious right there. When God removes his Spirit, boy, that makes me tremble. All for you. What did he do so bad, y'all? Did he steal from the temple? Did he disgrace the nation? I tell you what, it's real simple. You ain't even got to go to school for this one right here. He was disobedient. And some folk wonder why they can't get a breakthrough because of disobedience. God told him to do one thing. And let me help you out with this real quick. When I say folks speaking in your life, you got to be careful. Because check this out. God will have nothing to do with what they saying, and you will go and do it quicker for them than hearing the voice of God. God says, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Then someone coming to you, well, God don't gave me a word and told me you need to be. God ain't said nothing about that. When he specifically told you to stand still. All right then, I'm So, God said, look here, Saul. This is what needs to take place. You need to kill everything. Someone said, boy, that's a harsh God. God realized if you don't kill it now, it'll come back and get you later. So while I got you down here, kill everything. Everything. From the cradle to the grave. Kill it all, Saul. But Saul says, you know what? I take them little sheep and them goat over there because, you know, we're going to give a little sacrifice party for the Lord, you know what I'm saying? And he's going to appreciate that. Now he's thanking for God. And that's what we need to stop doing too. Stop thanking for God, all right? If he has enough sense to cause the sun to rise in the day and the moon at night, he has enough sense to handle your business and mine. So now, the battle's over. They won now. And some stuff come with a cost. The man of God comes down and he says, I hear a strange noise in the camp. Can I stop there for a minute? When we come in one accord in the church and we listen for one sound, and when something comes into the church, and it don't sound like us, and it don't act like us, it's a strange noise. Amen? It's a strange noise. Samuel said, there's a strange noise in the camp, man. He said, oh, yeah. Check this out. It seems like sheep ought to sound like sheep, and goat ought to sound like goat. But the enemy goats didn't sound like the goats of sacrifice for God. And the sheep of the enemy didn't sound like the sheep of sacrifice for God. So he said, there's a strange noise. Can I help you out? There's some wolves in sheep clothing up in here. And the king says, oh yeah, just wanted to tell you, we kept some stuff. We're gonna have a big party for the Lord tonight. You invited. And the prophet said, wait a minute. God gave you direct instructions. He said, kill everything. He says, look at here, man. And we use this at tithe and offering time, and it ain't got nothing to do with tithe and offering. He says, obedience is better than sacrifice, man. Don't you know God ain't caring about your sacrifice, but he wants your obedience. Let me move on. It says that the man of God begins to mourn. And God hears our hearts when we are sincere about the church. He hears it. He says, look, this is what you do. You get up, get yourself together, and I will show you your next king. You ain't got to call no church meeting. You ain't got to have no ballots. You ain't got to have 3/4 of the vote, because this guy, I knew him when he was in his mother's womb. I allowed y'all to do it your way, and it messed us up. I see his potential. Watch this, y'all. He gets up. He finished the conversation with God. He goes to Jesse's house, the Bethlehemite. He says, look here, I want to have it's like a surprise party. And I want your sons to come. And as they begin to line up, how many of you know God has a sense of humor? Yeah. He can make you do some crazy stuff. He lines up everybody, and they look. God says, nah, that's not the one. God says, he's not the one either. Well, look here, Lord, we about to run out of sons. There's no more sons, Lord. You don't have me to fill this horn with all. They went out there and killed the heifer. I don't sanctified everybody. And ain't no more sons. And don't you know sometimes your blessings come out of nowhere where you least expect it? The person you looked over, the person you said wasn't going to make it, the person that you said wasn't going to amount to nothing, don't you know that's the person that God's been working on? When other folks threw them to the wolves, when other folks threw them out, that's the one that God was looking at. So now, do you have any more? 7, y'all. And I know what y'all think the number 7 is, right? Y'all go to Bible study. 7 means the number of completion. Let me help you out. That meant that God was done with that task. Stop looking through the eyes of men and start looking through the eyes of God. The number eight means new beginning. So God says, I'm trying to do a new thing in you. You keep talking about what you used to do and what you used to. Let all that stuff go. I'm calling you to be number 8 because I'm doing a new thing in you. Yeah. So now, do you have any more? Well, yeah, I got one. And I don't know if you want him. He the baby boy. Matter of fact, some historians say the reason Jesse looked over him is because it was some baby mama drama. That David mama was not the mama of the other brothers. That's what some of them say now. But let me tell you something. Even in some broken stuff that you had nothing to do with, God can still bless you. Someone ought to shout right there. Where he at? He's down there tending sheep. Sheep, y'all. Well, bring him to me. Let me see what he look like. Lord, I know you ain't talking about this dude leading the nation of God. Y'all, can I paint the picture real quick? He probably got camel's hair on, hay in his hair, smell of dung. And he's dirty. Matter of fact, he's about 15 years old about this time, and he ain't even coordinated. He ain't even got no swag about him. He's just running and stumbling, But check this out. He doesn't have to give his resume of what he's done because God already see him. Amen. And God said, if y'all want to know about this dude, this is the same little boy with a slingshot, and he was killing lions and bears. This is the same little boy that laid in the nights with the sheep and warded off wolves. So I validate who he is. Here he come, y'all. And the prophet has to remind what God said. God said, quit looking on the outward appearance. Lord, you got to help me with this one. Samuel, stop looking at the outward appearance. And that's the problem sometimes. We look on the outward and never look on the inward. Because someone sang real good, because someone preached real good, because someone prayed real good, we think they're ready for church office. Help me out, somebody. But that same child who only know one prayer and can put their hands together and say, God is great, God is good, and Sunday morning service can have so much power. You ought to look at your neighbor. You ought to tell your neighbor, it's all about your heart right now. It's not about where you at or how many accolades, but when you do what you do, it got to come from the heart. And God saw in David, he said, if this little 15-year-old boy can manage himself to take care of little old sheep, I know he's able to take care of the nation. When things come in, he'll fight them off. When they need a word, he'll speak up for them. When they need prayer, he'll enter into the pavilion. So now, I'm almost finished. It says here that when David came up, it says that he was a pretty good looking dude. And God says, he's the one. Notice real quick, and I'm getting ready to leave, y'all. The oil never moved on the brothers. The more he tried to pour, the oil wouldn't come out. But as soon as David got there, all got to coming out. Let me help you out real quick, somebody. Understand this. What God has for you is just for you. I don't care how many times they try to imitate you. I don't care how many times they try to cookie cut you. If it's not the real thing, the oil will not pour. But when you show up with your raggedy self, when you show up with your messed up self, when you show up with your jacked up self, here comes the oil flowing out you. They don't understand it. They can't. It famines their mind. You ought to tell them that God knew you when you was in your mama's womb. It's all about the timing, y'all. People can play with it. People can try it. But honey, if it ain't for them, it's not for them. I need somebody in the house this morning that said, I thank God for my oil. Check it out real quick, y'all. It says that when the oil came down, that the Spirit of God fell fresh on the man. Do I have a witness up in here? And understand this. When the oil flows, God begins to open doors for you. When the oil flows, he begins to represent you. You look like a brand new dime. You shining like you never shined before. You ought to tell somebody, it's because I got the oil on me. Do I have anybody in the house? You know God sees your potential. It's because it's the oil that's in your life. Do I have anybody up in the house? You thank God for the oil in your life. You ought to tell somebody, it's from the crown of my head to the soles of my feet. I got to leave you now. I'm getting ready to go. But I want to tell you, choir, if you want to sing right, let the oil flow. To the musicians, if you want to play right, let the oil flow. To my preachers, if you want to preach right, let the oil flow. To my ushers,
ushers, if you want to be good ushers, let the oil flow to the deacons. If you want to be good deacons, let the oil flow to the church members. If you want to love God right, let the oil flow. Can I get a witness? I need about five of y'all that tell God right now, let my oil flow on me. Let my oil flow on me. It reaches to the highest mountain. It flows to the valley low. If you got oil in your life, celebrate right now. You know you don't, you know you're not worth it. You can't buy it. You can't borrow it. But for some reason, God reached way down to pick you up, to turn you around, to place your feet on solid ground, the solid rock. I stand, and all other ground is sinking sand. I got oil in my life. I got oil in my walk. I got oil in my talk. I got oil in my praise. Do you got any oil? Say yeah. 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 Let it fall. Let it fall. Let it fall. Fresh on me. Holy Spirit, fall. I said fall. Fresh on me. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, fall. Fresh, fresh, fresh on me. Say yeah, yeah, yeah. He sees you. Let me help you out. Some of y'all still haven't grabbed this. Let me show you what the prophet Samuel was seeing. Come here. Stand right there, Brother Kent. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I'm gonna show you what the prophet was saying. Joy. Joy. Bring baby. Bring baby Tyler down here. Let me show you. And this is us. I'm trying to help y'all. Don't stand in front of him, Kent. Stand in front of him. I'm bringing baby Tyler. Can y'all see him? See, we always look at a man's stature and we think they are fit for the job. But no God, no glory. You bear no cross, you get no crown. And because they in good stature, tall and strong, we say he's the one. But he may be the one in the eyes of men, but if he ain't got no oil in his life, it can't happen. And then because he's very intellectual, he's a thinker. He's a solver. He can do great things with his mind. We think they're ready. They can lead us to higher heights and deeper depths. But if there's no oil in their life, they're just foolish. But out of the mouth of babes, come on somebody. Look here. Out of the mouth of babes, God can lead. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Out of the mouth of babes, he can make me lie down in green pastures. And then out of the mouth of babes, when I get old and I'm reminded of the oil that's in my life, surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. So stop looking on the outward appearance and look where God is trying to use. Give God some praise right there. Come on. Someone ought to thank him. Someone ought to thank him.
The Lord sees your potential. Quit settling for seconds. Uh-oh, I got y'all next week. I need someone to do something for me next week. I need all this moved, and I need a table up here with some chairs. I take care of the rest. Quit settling for seconds. When God sees your potential, he sees your potential. Now let me help you out. What happened to David from the day he got anointed until the day he became the king? Wait. 15 years. 15 years. Saul messing with him. Saul trying to kill him. The Philistines, you know, he pimping out his gift. 1 minute, he tells the Philistine, I'll fight for y'all, but I won't fight if y'all gonna fight Israel. He pimping out his gift. He's in the desert. Folk won't give him no help. But through his experience, it taught him how to become a good king. And the thing about it is, even when David done wrong, he had enough sense to go to God and said, Lord, create in me a clean heart. And Lord, renew in me a right spirit. So don't think you won't mess up in that whole potential mode, okay? There's some things that are going to happen, but God haven't forgot about you. You might fail a test, but the main exam is the one you need to pass. And you got an open book test, amen? You got the word. So understand, he sees your potential. Someone said, I'm too old. No, you're never too old. You're never too old. God sees your potential. I want you to know that if I don't say nothing to you this week, God sees it, and he wants you to know it. You got greatness in you. Great. Am I talking to anybody in here? You have greatness in you. Give God some praise while we stand. I'm ready for us to tap into that thing, man. I'm ready for us to tap into it. As our spiritual leaders step out in the aisles, I want you to know this morning, it's great to know the Lord. How many of you know that? In your brokenness and in your bad ways, one thing the church has lied to folk about is that when you come to church, you're going to be holy all the time. And we'll take that one, Lord. You had nothing to do with that. Christianity is a lifestyle, truly. But the walk with God is every day. And on that walk, you're going to have some good days. You're going to have some bad days. Check this out. If you be real with yourself, that's some stuff you've been trying to let go for a long time and you just can't let it go. But it doesn't mean that God doesn't love you. It does not mean you're not saved. If you become totally saved right now, there's no need for you to come to church, to pray, or to even offer up sacrifice to praise to God. Because you got it all together. You're heaven bound. But how many of you know that every now and then you mess up? Every now and then you fall short. And that very thing you said you were not going to do, you find yourself doing. That's why I thank God that over 2,500 years ago, a man by the name of Jesus died on a cross. And he said this, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. I thank God that and my mess ups, he helps me to make up. when my convoluted mind don't want to do right, he makes me do right. I'm glad that he died. And now I have the right to talk to him. I want you to have that same right this morning. As the praise team sing, if you need to know the Lord, if you need to know who he is, if you need to be part of church, we invite you. I'm not concerned about what you done yesterday. I'm concerned about the now. I'm concerned about the now. And if you need church, if you need church family, I dare you to step out, grab one of our leaders' hands, and we fellowship into this body. Don't wait. Use the excuse, I'm going to get it right, and I'll be in church. You're not promised tomorrow.
Who so we invite you,
kidding of baptism, mission experience. You may come under watch care.
If your heart
it's your choice.
Broken,
it's between you and God.
Just lift your hands and say, oh, I know that I can make it. I know with him I know I can stand. No matter what may come my way,
if you would just for
my life is in your hands.
You. I want to let you know that the person's hand that you are holding has potential in them. I listen to Deacon Gardner tell this story all the time. He tells this story all the time. People think Kevin Garnett became great overnight. But Deke, you tell me if I'm wrong. You said you can remember when he was a little boy out there shooting when everybody else was in the house. He down at Deke's house and everybody else's house. And all he knew was to shoot basketball. That didn't happen overnight. He became great because he stayed at it. Don't give up on God because God has not given up on you. Don't stop loving God. He loves you in spite of. Let us pray because I want to speak this stuff into your life. Father, we thank thee right now. We thank you for your bountiful blessings and all that you've done for us. And God, we ask this morning that you would cover us, keep us, and Lord, console us and comfort us. Lord, there's so much potential in us, Lord, but God, give us patience, give us strength, give us power to wait on the Lord. And Lord, we thank you right now. Lord, we ask right now that whatever it is, Lord, that you have us seeking and searching, Lord, let us not give up. Let us continue to run the race. Let us continue to believe in you, trust in you, acknowledging you, Lord, in all things. We believe right now, Father God, that we're coming together, and we're coming not in self, but Lord, just like you found David, find that nugget in our heart that will cause us to do a great work for the kingdom. Bless us through our seasons, Father God. Lord, let us not become grudgingly and greedy, Lord, but let us become grateful for all the great and mighty, wonderful things you've done. Lord, let us grow in grace and in peace right now. Bless every household that's under the sound of my voice right now. Give us peace that surpasses all understanding. Lord, let us speak good words of each other. Let us become encouragers and not discouragers. Lord, let us be peacemakers and not peace breakers right now. We believe in the name of Jesus that we apply the blood to every household, every name, every child right now. We count it all done, Lord. We no longer walk in defeat, but we walk in victory. And we thank you.
Touch our bodies and our minds. It's in the mighty name of Jesus we do pray. If you believe this, if you receive this, tell God thank you right now. Say amen with me right now. Give God a praise right now. Come on, don't play with it. Amen. Amen. As we remain standing, God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. May heaven's glory always be in your life. Speak positive things over your life this week. And when the enemy come knocking on your door to try to bring up what you've done in the past, you tell him in your present state, you in love with the Lord. You are in love with the Lord, and he can't do nothing about it. Amen. Stay in love with the Master. Amen. As we prepare to leave, we're going to close in prayer, and we're 3-4. Amen. Father God, we thank you right now. We bless your name. As we leave this place, we ask that we're never from thy presence. Give us strength, Lord. Give us power and might. As we leave this place, we never, never want to leave you. It's in the mighty and marvelous name of him who died that we may have life and have it more abundantly. And we say amen. Let us say it 3-4.